welcome you to our morning worship here at Philippi this morning. If you're visiting with us, we are glad you're here with us today. We hope you find a big welcome here today. Good to see all the home folks back, and it's good to be back on stage with y'all this morning. So we're going to stand right now, if we would, and we're going to sing together Everywhere I Go.
Everywhere I go on this road, I know where I go with you.
With us on Lions. We talked about that during our week. Yeah, Alana, you're not the only one. Come on, girl. Kaden, come on. Rachel, there we come. Come on, guys. There's, all right, they're coming. Good job. Come on, Riley, guys. All right, so we're going to just kind of sing this song with us. The words are going to be on the screen so y'all can sing along with us as well. But day one, we learned, get all my notes here. And Miss Elaine, come on. Day one, Jesus' power helps us do hard things.
Trust Jesus.
There we go. And that day we learned about the account of Ananias meeting Paul for the first time there. And of course, we know the rest of the story. Pretty exciting. All right, day two was, Jesus' power gives us hope.
Trust Jesus.
All right, and this account that day was where Paul encouraged the others in the shipwreck. And we had an awesome shipwreck in the fellowship hall over there. So they cleaned up well, though. On day three, Jesus' power helps us to be bold.
Trust Jesus.
So that day we learned about Peter and John teaching about Jesus there at the synagogue. And then on day four, it was Jesus' power lets us live forever.
Trust Jesus.
And, of course, the account that day was of Jesus' death and resurrection. So the song that we're getting ready to sing, the song we just sang was one from VBS. This is one we sang at VBS, and then actually our communion song will also be from VBS, but it's one that you guys will all know. So we're going to go ahead and do Lions. Go ahead and stand and join us and sing along. The words will be on the screen.
You guys spread out.
And while you're standing, we had 54 kids registered over the 4 days. So on the average with adults and all, 70, 75 here each night. And we did meet our goal for Canvas Church, which was pretty amazing. I'm so proud of everybody there. And we made $16.21, I think, or $16.11.21. So it was amazing. Yeah. Over 1600. Yeah.
Lions. Benj looks a little different than he did the other night.
So this song is called Lions.
Today we live, today we breathe, today we know that we are strong when we are weak. Today we trust, we overcome, take every chain that kept us slaves and throw them off. We're not waiting for permission, we defy our inhibition, like God will make this fearless son of red. If we're gonna fly, we fly like eagles.
We prepare to come around the Lord's table this morning. We're going to be using the old rugged cross.
Mm-hmm.
morning.
Good morning.
Every time we do VBS songs here at church, and we always do those generally after a week of VBS. I remember back to when I was a kid going to VBS, and I'm sure most of you all do too. We all have certain memories. I remember one year, I was probably about 5 years old, but we were going to come to VBS, and back in those days, it was in the mornings, and roughly about 9 to 12, but Mom, my brother Doug and I were about a year apart in age, so she had a tendency to try to dress us like twins, and she went out and bought us a matching outfit of yellow gold shorts and horizontal striped shirts, polyester all the way. This was the early 70s, and so off we came over here wearing our gold shorts and striped shirts and matching bowl haircuts. And even at 5 years old, I knew that was not cool. If Mama said do it, you did it. Anyway, but I remember the teachers, and some of them are still in here today. I see you out there. And it was such a great time, and I know you have great VBS memories too growing up. And it's so important that we, number one, continue to try to do VBS here at Philippi, but number two, it's great to just simply sit and remember good times in the past that maybe didn't seem good at the time, but now we look back and laugh at them. And that's the point of communion. It's a time to simply sit and remember something very significant in all of our lives and in the life of the world. It's to remember the death, burial, resurrection, crucifixion of Jesus Christ there on the cross. He instituted it through what's often referred to as the Last Supper. And the point of it was to remember him, to remember his sacrifice there at Calvary, and what it means to each and every one of those of us who belong to him. You know, we live in a crazy world, and as soon as we walk out of here, most of us are in 40 different directions until this time next week. And it's, I think it, he knew what, obviously he knew what he was doing. You know, weekly we come together and sit in a quiet time and contemplate and think about that event and that sacrifice that he made. Because to be brutally honest, were it not for his sacrifice on the cross, you and I would have no chance of eternal life in heaven, period. And I don't know about you, but you can read up a little bit on what heaven's like and then read up on what hell is like, and I'll be honest with you, I want to be on the heaven side. And I think all of you all do too. So as we partake this morning, let's remember that blood and body that was broken there at Calvary, and remember what it's like to be a Christian and reconnect, if only momentarily here this morning. Just block everything going on in the world. Just block that out of our minds and just concentrate on Jesus and what he did for you and I there at Calvary. We'll partake first of the bread. And as Jesus said when he was talking there to the disciples, he said, "This is my body, eat in remembrance of me." Next we'll do the juice. And again, Jesus told them, "This is my blood, drink in remembrance of me." Let's have a prayer. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you so much for being that perfect sacrifice there at Calvary. Lord, we know that only through you can we ever get to heaven. And we know it took the shedding of blood and breaking of your body, the one and only perfect sacrifice, Lord. And we pray that as we partake this morning, we will remember and think and dwell on that moment. And thank you, Lord, for being that willing sacrifice, who was unjustly accused and convicted, but nevertheless followed the Lord, the Father's will, Lord. Be with us now as we go. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. praise you this morning that we can know that we are yours. Lord, we just don't even understand how such an awesome God could make this universe, the oceans and the mountains and the seas, and yet you care for us, God. Just like you molded the earth with your hands, you will mold our lives. You will protect us when we fall, God. We thank you that we know that we are yours this morning. In Jesus' name.
This time I'd like to dismiss our K through 5th grade back to bench in the back for our junior church. I'd like to welcome our guests or visitors that might be with us today. Our bathrooms are over here on the right. Our toddler class is over here, and our offering box is at the door here. If you need any other assistance, I'd be glad to help you out with anything that you might need here at the church, and we're glad you're with us today. We're starting a new series today, and Sharon's kicked that off in great fashion. And the first message is, who am I? I was thinking as she was singing, the sign language to I am yours is, I am yours. Do that with me? I am yours, or yours, whichever way you want to flip your hand around. We certainly are. I want to ask you a couple of questions. I kind of put this out in our article in our newsletter this week. How do we grow in Christ? How do we defeat Satan's personal attacks against us? In other words, if you want to word it differently, and by what means do we find consistent victory over temptation and over darkness? Now, I know that's a big question. It's all-encompassing, you know. But I think it deserves our meticulous consideration because it affects our witness. It affects even our salvation. I think we need to start where the Bible starts. We've got to have a true knowledge of who we are in God, that we are His children. I think if we really knew God as we should, then our behaviors, our attitudes, our spiritual well-being, if you would change radically. And I believe it would change rapidly. Perhaps one of the greatest detriments, if you will, maybe to our spiritual growth, to our spiritual health, to our spiritual freedom in Christ, is a lack of understanding of who God is and our relationship with Him as His children. In short, you could kind of put it like this: right belief precedes right behavior. Again, right belief precedes right behavior. The battle for our mind is a real thing. You agree with me? Amen? We think about Scripture, and we hear it even said, not in Scripture, you are what you think. The Bible tells us, you know, for as a man thinks within himself, so he is. And no wonder Scripture says we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. We're in a war. But it's a different kind of war than what's going on in Afghanistan, which, by the way, breaks my heart, what's happening over there. But it's a different kind of war. Look at what Scripture says in Ephesians 6:12. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And that victory over these spiritual forces of evil, it's not attainable on our own. We're not going to do it by ourselves. It's only within us recognizing that we need God's help. And in His help, we can overcome that darkness. And we can experience the freedom that we can have in Christ Jesus. You know, God calls us to do this. He says, don't be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed how? By the renewing of our minds. That's right. As we're not conformed, as we're not made into the image of the world, we walk by faith in the power and the Spirit of God, and we transformed our mind. And by doing that, then we develop healthy patterns of behavior and attitude to defeat the darkness. Now, I don't know if you're like me, and I kind of think some of you probably are, but sometimes I like to rush through things. I like things to get done quicker than they really should. For example, we'll be cooking, and Nadine gets on me about all the time, but do you have the burner on high? Like, yeah, I've turned it on high. But it didn't call for high, because what's going to happen if you turn it on high lots of times? Are you going to burn it? You're going to boil it over? I do it all the time, because I want to rush it, you know. Putting together something. I skim through the instructions or take the instructions and throw them on the side and I put it together and what happens? I got this missing. I wonder where that went. You know, and then it doesn't work right because I rushed through that, if you will. Or when I leave work, and my fellow employees around here can tell you, I leave my wallet or I leave my church keys or I leave my coffee cup or on my desk inevitably all the time. Because I get out the door and I realize, that, where did I put that? And then I just leave it in a hurry. I do that. You know, and see, sometimes I think we do the same sort of thing with the Bible. Hear me out. I think we kind of skip over the theology stuff that maybe we're not really that interested in. And we hurry right on to the books of James and the book of Proverbs. How many of you like those books? That's two of my favorite books in the Bible. Why? Because I like to say they're practical. You know, they tell me what to do and what not to do. That's really why I like them so much. But what happens so often is that we don't understand who we are and why we're here. And so we keep slipping right back into the same bad habits that we've always done. And so one of the best, and I'm going to say as we develop through this series, the really only way to grow in Christ is to first recognize who we are in Christ. The more we affirm who we are in Christ, the more our behavior, the do's and the don'ts, they're going to begin to reflect who we are in Christ, our maturity, our identity in Him. So I really look forward to this new series as we discover how to walk in Christ joyfully, triumphantly, conquering the darkness because we know who we are. So let's first just talk about this morning our search for identity in the world. I remember years ago, and maybe I shared with you, doing an Emmaus walk. Anybody done that, by the way, an Emmaus walk? You know what I'm talking about? Okay, a few of you have. You spend a weekend away from home with most of the time people that you really don't know. And you focus on God and His love and the love of others. But one of the things you can't do, which I thought was really strange when I first did, is you can't tell others what you do for a living. That's just one of the things you don't talk about. And I was surprised how much that I might talk about what I do for a living and how much others did for a living. We just couldn't talk about those things. It led us to talk about, guess what? More important, more spiritual things. Have you ever asked somebody, who are you? For example, they may say, well, my name is John Smith. What if you just said to them, no, that's your name? And they'd say, well, I'm John Smith, but I am Denise's husband, or my dad is Bob, or I've got a boy named Herman, you know, or whatever. You say, no, that's your family heritage. And they may say, well, I'm a truck driver. And they said, no, that's what you do. They may say, well, I'm white and I'm American. And they say, no, that's your ethnicity and that's where you live. By now, they're probably getting a little frustrated with you. And they may say, well, I'm blonde, I'm 5'10", I weigh 235 pounds. No, that's your physical description. So they may get a sense that you want something spiritual. So they say, well, I'm a member of Philippi Church of Christ and I'm a youth sponsor. And you say, no, that's the church you belong to and that's your role there. Are you confused by now? The Apostle Paul said, we recognize no man according to the flesh. Now, the early church didn't recognize people that way, but usually we do. You see, the previous answers were really according to the flesh. You see, we commonly identify ourselves by what we look like, where we live, what we do, who our family is, what church we go to, what we do at that church, or various other fleshly descriptions. But I want to change the question a little bit. Listen to me. Follow along with me now. This is a better question. Here's the question. How does God see you? How does God see you? Who are you in His eyes? Who are you in relationship to Him? Now think about this. Is who you are determined by what you do, or is what you do determined by who you are? One more time. Is who you are determined by what you do, or is what you do determined by who you are? That's really the pivotal question in this whole series we're going to talk about. Because, in other words, I believe we behave as we believe. Our beliefs follow, or our behavior follows what we truly believe in our heart. For example, somebody truly believes that they're a patriot and they're an American, they'll give their life for their country. They'll lay down their life for it. Same thing as I truly love my wife, I would lay down my life for my wife. Jesus Christ loved us, and what did he do? He laid down his life for you and me. Our hope for victory over the darkness, for spiritual growth, for Christian fulfillment and meaning in life is based on who we are in Christ, particularly that we're his children. Our understanding of who God is and who we are in him is the indispensable foundation that we've got to build on. Our belief systems, our behavior patterns, everything is a Christ follower. I think about Solomon. Solomon searched for his identity. So much so, he wrote a book about it, Ecclesiastes. He had the power, he had position, he had prestige, he had possessions, he had a posse of women for his pleasure, so to speak, and he was prudent. He was the wisest of the wise. Now, if a meaningful life is a result of your appearance, of admiration, of accomplishments, of status, of wealth, of brilliance, of pleasure, then Solomon should have been the most satisfied, the most content, the most fulfilled man who ever lived. Because he had it all. But here's the words we hear coming from his mouth. Meaningless, meaningless, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. It's a chasing after the wind. Now Solomon wasn't the average Joe, was he? What had God given him above all other men? Wisdom. Wisest of the wise. And so when he possessed this wisdom, he looked all the things that God gave him, and he tried to interpret the meaning of them all. And instead of finding purpose and meaning and identity in this way of life, here he said, it's all meaningless. But isn't that where the world looks today? Isn't that where we oftentimes look for our identity in this world? Ecclesiastes said it was meaningless. Solomon said it was meaningless. Let me ask you, do we take Solomon at his word? Maybe sometimes, but oftentimes we don't. You see, I think we often buy into the negative side of this. Also, the fleshly identity, if you will, creates in us a person that says, well, that's the formula for success. All the things that Solomon had. And we often believe that life devoid of all those things that Solomon had is nothing. And we're not going to be happy if we don't have the material things, if we don't have the looks, if we don't have the smarts, if we don't have the power, if we don't have the prestige, you know, if we don't have the big bank account, if we don't have the retirement, if we don't have the right job, the important relationships, if we don't have those things, then we're nobodies. And we got nothing to live for. Now, if you do the earthly math, which I figured up earthly and fleshly, that's probably going to come out about right in people's eyes. That's the way it's going to figure. Most everybody else is going to look at it and say, yeah, they're pretty much a nobody. They ain't got nothing going for them. But when we do God's eternal math, when we look at his kingdom, that's certainly not true. With his math, it's totally different. Because in God's kingdom, meaning, purpose, wholeness, they're not products of what we have or don't have, or what we've done or haven't done. We are loved by God. We're a possession of his with infinite meaning and purpose because we're his what? We're his children. We belong to him. Look what the Bible says. John 1:12. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become what? Children of God. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. So here's an equation that we might could kind of pick up on, that us plus Christ equals wholeness and meaning. Us plus Christ equals wholeness and meaning. But I want us to go a little further this identity today, because I think Satan would not want us to expose false identities and to look at them a little deeper. Because if we look at these false identities, I think it will help us understand what our true identity is. So if our relationship with God is the key to wholeness, if us plus Christ equals wholeness, then why is it that so often we as Christians struggle with our identity, with our significance, with our security, with growing in Christ, with sensing our worth even at times? I think many of us don't recognize our identity because of lack of knowledge of God. our intimate knowledge that we once had in the Garden of Eden that we see Adam and Eve had with him as they walked, that knowledge has been lost, if you will. Now, that knowledge was relational. I know we normally think of knowledge as being like this. You know, I know something. But the Bible talks of it differently. In fact, we go right to the beginning of Genesis, it said Adam knew his wife, and she conceived. What did he say? Hey, how you doing, Eve? You know, was that kind of knowledge he had of Eve? No, that's not talking about that. He had an intimate knowledge of her in that way, and she conceived. And the Bible talks about that as we know God, as an intimate knowledge of God. We got a relationship with him. So when Adam and Eve were sinned and they were banished from the garden, they lost their relationship with God. They lost that intimate connection with him. So in our sinful state, we may know something about God, but do we really know God? No, we're far from him. We have no relationship with him. Look how Paul put it. The person without faith does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but consider sinners in foolishness. You don't listen to that stuff, Glenn. You're talking about Solomon? You don't listen to that junk. They can't understand them because they're discerned only how? What's he say? Through the Spirit. As we have the Spirit of God in us, then we say, oh yeah, that's right. I see that now. We look at Ephesians 4:18. He says they are darkened in their understanding, separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. They're not listening. They don't have that knowledge there. Hosea said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. So when we're led by sin, when we're led by the devil, we're prone to forget. If we're following down his path, we forget God's divine purpose for us. We forget who we are in God. We forget that all our needs are provided by God. That's where we need to look. We forget that we belong to God and we should be about his purposes because we're his children. So Satan blinds us. He also blinds us to the fact that you and I are temporal. Our bodies have an expiration date. I was looking at my milk yesterday. We had bought another gallon of milk the week before because I thought milk was going to go out. That did go out. Went out the 5th. Anybody ever have milk that just lasts and lasts and lasts? You know? Ever have a loaf of bread? We had a loaf of bread that lasted over a month some time ago. I don't know if it's humidity or what. It went to it just as fresh as could be. The expiration date long gone out of them. Just still fresh, you know? But I tell you, you and I got an expiration date on us, don't we? We don't like to say it like that. The author of our book here, he said, we have a disposable earth suit. No wonder Paul called us. He said, our bodies are like what? Tents. Stayed in a tent? Temporary. I bet none of you stayed in a tent for months or years because it's a temporary place. You don't like to stay in a tent. It's temporary. And he says our bodies are temporary. Benoy last week said he had his skin suit on. I like the way he said that, you know? Well, the devil's fiendish plot is this. He wants us to think only of the here and now. You ever see that? You ever notice that's how he does things? You know, if we're going to find true meaning, and we're going to find true meaning forever, we need to look past the here and now, past this world. He wants you to concentrate on your needs and your wants right now. Seek others' approval, others' applause, no matter the consequences, right now. Basically, find your identity outside of God, outside of his purposes in your life. Going to be a little bit of trouble this morning, though. A little lemon juice for me here. That cuts. So others refuse not only out of ignorance, but refuse just because they're unrepentant. They're carnal. Paul put it like this. He said, because of your stubbornness, your unrepentant heart. We say words like pig-headed, or you're obstinate, or you're just stubborn. And this comes as a result of the fall. I don't know if you ever thought about it or not, but mankind became depressed and angry. Think of it. You remember when Cain brought his offering to God? Was God pleased with it? No. The Bible doesn't really tell us exactly why. I mean, we can conjecture. But the Bible also says that God knows what? He knows our heart. He knows why, how Cain offered it, whether he gave the best of what he had, or was he slacking that? We don't know, but here's what happened. Look at Genesis 4:5-7. We pick up. But on Cain and on his offering, he, the Lord, did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry. His face was downcast. Notice the two things. He was angry and he was depressed. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you. You must rule over it." You see, Cain's anger, Cain's depression, stemmed from not doing what was right. He connects the dots through there. This is why you are the way you are. And it was multiplied even more when he did what? When he killed his brother. God is saying, you don't feel your way into good behavior, but you behave yourself into good feelings. As you do what is right, then it brings joy to you. It brings happiness. It brings fulfillment. Jesus said, if you know these things, you'll be blessed. You'll be happy if you do them. When we stubbornly choose our own way, thinking it's going to bring joy, it's going to bring freedom, it actually does the opposite. It brings slavery. It brings sadness to us and become trapped in the webs and the lies as Satan is there in his deceit. And he becomes our master. If you don't believe it, look what Scripture says. Look what Paul, how Paul put it. "For sin shall no longer be your master, because you're no longer under law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we're not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourself to someone as obedient slaves, you're slaves to the one you obey, whether you're a slave to sin or to Satan, which leads to death, or you're slaves to obedience, which leads to righteousness, which leads to heaven, which is God." So here's one of the traps, if you will. There's ignorance and there's stubbornness or disobedience. There's unrepentance. And the Bible tells us that Satan is the father of what? Say it with me. Satan is what? Father of lies. So let's look at some of his lies that he gets us with sometimes. This is one of the distortions. Because of mankind's fall in the garden, acceptance was replaced by rejection. Before the fall, Adam and Eve, they still had a need to belong, and they filled that belonging with a fellowship with God. It's not good for Adam to be alone, so God even made Eve to supply more fellowship for him. But then Adam and Eve sinned, and that introduced strife in the relationships. Remember the blame game, you know? Adam says it was her. She gave me the fruit. Started right off in the garden, you know? A blame game going on. And then we have problems right within that as they're kicked out of the garden. They're not walking and talking with God. They're covering themselves with leaves, knowing now that they're not innocent in that way. We've always had a deep longing to belong. It's made within us. Even the people that come to Christ, are baptized in Christ, they need us. They need a community of believers as well, as well as God. And today, our need to belong and not experience rejection causes us to look in all the wrong places for that belonging, to fill that need, unholy relationships, impure sexual encounters, succumbing to peer pressure from countless ungodly groups and friends, cult memberships as well, succumbing also to connections to worldly groups and social clubs that we might be involved in. And we could go on and on. Paul put it like this. He said, "Don't be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can we, the light, have with darkness, which we need to try to find victory over? But instead, we get in bed together with darkness." Because he's blinded us. He's blinded us with that distortion that you need to belong. You need to find somebody to belong to. You need to find some sense of belonging because it's there. But that hole in our heart is meant for who? That's right, for God. To belong to him in that way. Now listen to another one of his distortions. Because of mankind's fall in the garden, innocence was replaced by guilt and shame. You see, if we don't find the forgiveness and the grace in Jesus' sacrificial death on the cross, then we seek to place that guilt and that shame in another way. We seek to try to fill it, to get rid of it. We seek self-worth by looking for other people's approval, by pulling ourselves up by our own bootstraps. You can do it. You'll be all right. working harder, looking better, learning more, being more gifted, gaining more additional things. But none of those will remove the guilt and shame, no matter how much we do. Our sense of worth comes again by knowing that we are God's children. We're His. We belong to Him. We'll talk about that more in the coming weeks. The last distortion I'd like to throw at you is, because of mankind's fall in the Garden of Eden, dominion is replaced with weakness and with helplessness. Adam had dominion over all the earth. The Bible says that. Everything was under him. He was made in the image of God. But then sin came. He was kicked out of the garden, unable to partake of the tree of life anymore. He's not in the control anymore. And he lost that. Now, oftentimes, I think Satan manipulates us to try to manipulate others so we can feel in control, that we can get control of other people in our life. Or we learn some sort of discipline so we can say, well, this is what I've done. You know, I've lost this amount of weight, or I give this amount of money, or I'm able to control my... And we look at what we've done, and we kind of say things like, well, we're the master of our fate. We're the captain of our soul. We've done this. Now, certainly the fall brings sickness and death, so none of us, unless Jesus comes first, are going to defeat death. Not without Jesus Christ. Satan wants us to forget that. He wants us to forget that we're weak, that we're all going to die. He says, hey, just get control. Don't show your weakness, you know. Go it alone. Be your own man. Be your own woman. You got this. I want to tell you this morning, we don't have this without Christ. Say that with me. We don't have this without Christ. We like to say we got this. There's nothing wrong with growing in self-control. The Bible says it's one of the fruits of the Spirit. You remember what it says? It's a fruit of the Spirit. God gives that. Don't play God and act like you don't need Him, that you got this. Because extreme efforts in self-control lead to legalism. They lead to perfectionism. And when we don't need God, we can matter the letters of the law. I've gone to church every Sunday. I've done this. I haven't cussed. I haven't chewed. I haven't gone with girls that do. And I throw that in there. Our soul is not destined to function as master, is it? Who's our master? God. We're to serve Him. Love others. The Bible says, Jesus asked the greatest commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. So we're to serve Him and others. That's His way. That's His righteousness. That's being part of putting His kingdom first. And when we seek to fulfill these needs because of the fall of mankind in a way that's not right, then what happens is we feel pressured to fit in because we need to belong, and peer pressure works on us, and we do things we really don't want to do, and we succumb to temptation that we really don't want to, but we forget in that way. And we like to improve our image because this is the way the world sees it. And these are things that are important to the world. So these things should be important to us. And, you know, we need to have some control in our life. And so we manipulate people and we do things to get people's applause. So you can see these basic needs are used by Satan to direct us in wrong paths. I tell you today, our identity is not and should not be on the things that the devil offers. But our identity should be, how? In Christ. God wants us to know who we are so we can live accordingly. Do you believe that today? He wants you to know today who you are. We fail, so we often see ourselves as failures, which only leads to more failure. We sin, so we see ourselves as sinners, which only leads to more sin. I think we've been deceived so long by the great deceiver that what we do determines who we are. That false belief leads to hopelessness. It leads to defeat. It leads to more sinfulness. How many of us have said, I'm a sinner saved by grace? Probably everyone here. Is it true? Yes. But you know the first thing that you're saying? I am a... what? Sinner. Ever thought about that? That's the first thing comes out of your mouth, that you're a sinner? How much do we focus on that we sin? Oh, can't help it. We all do. We all sin. So we focus so much on that we're a sinner oftentimes we see ourselves as what? What? Sinners, not children of God. God, on the other hand, tells us this. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are what? One more time. Children of God. God wants us to know who we are in Christ so we can live up to a godly potential. Being a child of God is being alive in Christ. And when we're alive in Christ, that determines what we do. Now, because of the fall, our acceptance, our innocence, our dominion, they were replaced again with rejection and guilt and shame and weakness. But when we're alive in Christ, we now have significance. We have security. We have acceptance. If you would, grab these sheets that you found in your bulletin and out right now. And if you don't have one, could somebody back, Gerald, I don't know, or somebody back there in the back, grab some of our bulletins out there? Would you do that? Or Linda? Or who back there in the back? I can see. Paul? Would you guys raise your hand if you don't have one of these and you need one? Okay, we've got one here. Yep, several over here. Thanks. Let the young man go for them. Yeah. Paul said, I did enough with the train this week. Paul was our mechanic on our little train. We had taken our kids around, worked on that almost every day, didn't you, Paul? Appreciate that. Got her going. Okay, as we're getting some more bulletins and getting these, I want you to look at these, and what we're going to do is flip over to the back side first, okay, where it says, I am significant. Now, what I want us to do is just to reaffirm who we are. We're going to read these out loud, okay? I'm going to do the scripture, okay, and then you and I together will read who we are in Christ. Okay? If you don't have one, raise your hand again. Okay? Here it comes. Raise your hand high. My wife up front doesn't have one. I had to do that to you. Love you. Who else doesn't have one? Okay, right here. Anybody else? Who needs one? Anybody? Okay. Let's go to the back and look at Matthew 5, 13 through 14 tells us what? I am the salt and light of the earth. John 15, 1 and 5 tells us together, I am a branch of the true vine, a channel of His life. John 15, 16 tells us together, I have been chosen and appointed to bear fruit. Acts 1, 8 says, I am a personal witness of Christ. 1 Corinthians 3, 16 says, I am God's temple. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 through 21, I am a minister of reconciliation for God. 2 Corinthians 6, 1, together, I am God's co-worker. Ephesians 2, 6, I am seated with Christ in the heavenly realm. Ephesians 2, 10, I am God's workmanship. Together, Ephesians 3, 12, I may approach God with freedom and confidence. And Philippians 4, 13, I know you know this one, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You see, these verses reaffirm to us that we are significant in God. Do you believe that? Amen? We mean something to God. We have significant meaning in our life and purpose to do these things, to be salt and light, to be ambassadors for Christ, to be witnesses for Him. So now let's look at the one that says, I am accepted, the very first one. This is in John 1:12. I am God's child. John 15:15, together. I am Christ's friend. Romans 5:1. I have been justified. 1 Corinthians 6, 17. Together, I am united with the Lord, and I am one spirit with Him. 1 Corinthians 6, 20. I have been bought with a price. I belong to God. 1 Corinthians 12, 27. I am a member of Christ's body. Ephesians 1, 1. I am a saint. Now, I know that was hard coming out of your mouth. I'm going to try it one more time. I am a saint. You think of that as something totally different, don't you? That's for another sermon. We'll talk about that. Ephesians 1, 5. I have been adopted as God's child. Ephesians 2, 18. I have direct access to God through the Holy Spirit. Colossians 1, 14. I have been redeemed and forgiven of all my sins. And Colossians 2, 10. I am complete in Christ. These verses show us the acceptance that God has for us, that we belong to Him, that we are His. And oftentimes when we forget who we are, we need to read these verses to reaffirm who we are in Christ. Here are verses that tell us about our security in Christ, that what He's done for us and how we can be sure of our salvation. Look at Romans 8, 1 and 2 together. I am free from condemnation. Romans 8:28. I am assured all things work together for good. Romans 8:31 through 34. I am free from any condemning charges against me. Romans 8:35 through 39. I cannot be separated from the love of God. 2 Corinthians 1:21 through 22. I have been established, anointed, and sealed by God. Philippians 1:6. I am confident that the good work God has begun in me will be perfected. Or I think some verses says will be what? Completed. Philippians 3:20. I am a citizen of where? Heaven. Colossians 3:3. I am hidden with Christ in God. 2 Timothy 1:7. I have not been given a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and discipline. Hebrews 4:16. I can find grace and mercy in a time of need. And 1 John 5:18, I am born of God, and the evil one cannot touch me. We have this security in God. We have this acceptance in God. We have this significance in God. Now, I'm going to ask you, why not take these home? Post them somewhere where you can see them. You know, maybe it's your refrigerator. Maybe it's by your sink. It'd be refrigerator for me. I get past all the pictures of Ava and Emma there. But that's where it's going to be for me. But maybe it's somewhere in a prominent place that you need. So you can look at these regularly. Maybe it's your bathroom sink. You get up in the morning and look in the mirror and see who you are. This tells you who you are. In a way, every temptation that we face, everyone that the devil throws at us, is really a temptation to get us to live independently of God, to try to do it our way. Very old commercial, Burger King, do it your way, you know, have it your way, Burger King. Special orders, don't upset us, that kind of thing. Anyway, we're going back a while for some of you. As we think about doing it our way, it gets us in trouble. We live independent of God. But these needs of acceptance and significance and security, they need to be met. And we're going to try to meet them in some shape, form, or fashion. It's just who we are. But the question comes, are we going to meet these needs by the world, by the devil, by the flesh? Are we going to allow these needs to be met by God the Father, which the Bible tells us He is able to meet our needs according to His riches and the glory in Christ Jesus? So who are you going to let meet your needs? Who are you? Better question is, who are you in Christ? We are what? Children of God. We are children of God. If you're here today and you are a Christian, you're a child of God. Remember that. Remember that this week as Satan attacks you and tries to cause you to get your identity to be something different than what God intends it for it to be. If you're outside of Christ today, you truly can say, I am a potential child of God, because the Bible says when we become Christians, His Spirit comes and lives within us, that we become His children. We're adopted. We're sealed by the Holy Spirit in that way. And so maybe some of you today need to come to the Lord for the very first time, to accept Him, to repent of your sins, to be baptized into Christ, receiving the forgiveness of your sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit. If you need to do that, I pray that you will. Last 2 weeks, we've had two different ones that have come. Had Joel come the week before. Last week in our second service, we had Jewel Sampson, who was baptized into Christ. Maybe there's somebody else today that needs to come to the Lord. If you do, don't wait. Don't leave this place the way you are. Come to Him. Become one of His followers. Become one of His children. Let's stand together and sing our closing song today. I surrender all. Savior, I surrender all. announcements just to share with you. First of all, let's give a hand of applause for those that helped with VBS this week. Thank you so much. I'd like to thank Lisa and all the crews that helped with it. I point out a few people, but thank you so much for helping with our Vacation Bible School, making it a success. And Kevin's ecstatic about the money that was raised for Canvas Church as well. He's asked us to be in prayer for them as they're about a month away from launch. And so they've got a lot going on, and as he was with us, and they would talk with us this week, so just pray for them. And I think he's going to send us a video. We're going to have a special prayer time in just a few weeks for their church, so remember them. Our teens have an outing coming up, so remember that's going on, and I don't remember the date or time.
Somebody Saturday, we're leaving at 8 o'clock.
This coming Saturday?
This Saturday, leaving the church at 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock, okay. Any other announcements? My closing announcement, any others?
I need to see the flag team.
Okay, Stephanie would like to see the flag team after service. Okay, just up front. Okay, all right. The Gumneck Church has had an outbreak of COVID, a lot of folks in their church. In fact, there's a lot of COVID going on in our area, if you're not aware of that. So be aware. We put something in the newsletter about that. Be aware of that. Be safe. As well, be in prayer for churches that are going through that and through our country as well as there's big outbreaks going on. Okay? Anything else? We'll be letting you know a little bit more where we stand with that. We've got a meeting tomorrow night. Okay? Let's have a closing prayer. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Thank you so much for allowing us to be called your children. Because of who we are, help us, Father, to live as your children, as your disciples, as victors over darkness. Because we look to the end of the book in Revelation and we know we're more than conquerors through Christ Jesus our Lord, that you've overcome. The devil has been defeated. And we look forward to the day we can be with you. We ask, Lord, that you be with our fellow congregation, the sickness that's going on, even in our community. We ask for blessings and strength and healing. Father, help us to be your church as we go from this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said? Amen. Amen. Glad you're here this morning.